हेलो हाँ
वन सेकंड।
I think we have 2 more minutes to start.
Let me please give welcome address, then you can start, sir. No problem.
Okay.
Good evening, everyone. It's indeed a proud moment for me today, since I got this precious opportunity to welcome and introduce the speaker of today's session. The speaker of today's session is Mr. Rajsekhar V.S., Project Assistant, IISc Bangalore, and my beloved student. Rajsekhar has finished his Master's in Advanced Manufacturing Technology from Shastra University. His area of interest is bio-inspired robots and mechanism design of robots. Also, he has published more than 20 papers in the area of robotics and holds the US patent for his invention, Robotic Snake. While I was going through his profile, I found that I need at least an hour to talk about all the achievements Rajsekhar has accomplished till date. Only due to this time constraint, I am stopping here and proudly welcome Mr. Rajsekhar to present the session. Welcome, Rajsekhar. Next, I would like to welcome all those enthusiastic participants, professors and students of various engineering colleges who have accepted the invitation and registered for this event. I guarantee that you won't regret spending your precious 1 hour on this Saturday evening. Once again, welcome you all for this wonderful session. Thank you. Mr. Rajsekhar, you can start now.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful introduction. I welcome everyone for the webinar on design of robots. My name is V.S. Rajsekhar, and I'm a project assistant at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Today, we will be seeing how I have designed robots in my life and the design principles that I have followed so that you can also follow the same principles to make your wonderful robots which you think about. My area of interest is centered towards robotics and particularly mobile robots, bio-inspired robots, computer-aided multi-body dynamics, manipulators, aerial grasping, computer-controlled robots, mechanism design, and compliant robots. You can find the slide numbers on the right bottom of the screen. If you have any doubts, you can note down the slide number. We can discuss it at the end. The overview of the presentation is as follows. Today, I'll be giving a brief introduction to robotics, a brief introduction to mechanisms, and I'll be talking about the application of planar mechanisms in robotics, the application of spatial mechanisms in robotics, and the maths involved in designing robots. The goal of this presentation is to provide you an idea where the robots can be used and understand the importance of mechanisms. It is also to get to know the difference between planar and spatial robotic mechanisms and understand the role of mathematics in designing robots. A brief introduction to robotics. As you can see on the screen, this is a humanoid robot based on 5-bar mechanism, and I have designed it in such a way that it can walk and jump. The unique property of this is that it is a simple mechanism and it can jump sideways. More about this will be discussed in the further slides. Coming to why robots, why do we need robots is that because of the 4D jobs which exist in the world. The 4D consists of dull, dirty, dangerous, and difficult jobs which are done by humans and could be replaced by robots in such a way that they can take over these tasks and give us an opportunity to work on other things which are much needed for life. You can see a snake robot on the left side bottom, which I have designed in 2015. A robotic arm in the center, it was computer controlled robotic arm, and its graphics of it is available over here. And on the right side bottom, you can see a mobile robot based on 4-bar mechanism. Before going to know what a robot is, we should know what a robot is not. A CNC machine, for example, is not a robot. Although it is reprogrammable, it is not multifunctional in nature. A remote controlled toy is not a robot, because it cannot be programmed, but it can be receive signals only from the user. Coming to what is a robot is something which is multifunctional in nature and it can do multiple tasks and it should be reprogrammable. The figure on the left shows India's first indigenous robot developed by Tata, and I was proud to be a part of it. It is a robot which has 5 axes and can be used in the industries. It is reprogrammable and multifunctional, and it can do jobs like welding, pick and place, sorting, etc. The robot on the right is a soft robot which I made during my spare time. It consists of links which are soft in nature and can be used to make smooth motions on floors. Coming to the parts of the robot, the parts of the robot consists of links, joints, actuators, sensors, microcontroller, power supply, and driver board. What you see here is the link, which is used to drive the robot. What you see here is the microcontroller. What you see here is the actuator, which is needed to actuate the robot. And this robot is in the development stage, and it doesn't have sensors connected to it. You'll be seeing the power supply and the driver board in the upcoming slides. Before going to know about robot mechanisms, we should know what a binary link is. Binary link is something, a mechanical structure or a rod, in which two joints can be fixed to it. It is called as a binary link. A ternary link is something where three joints can be attached to it. 1, 2, and 3. A quaternary link in a similar way can have four joints attached to it, and pentanary, hexanary, and so on. These are the various linkages which one should have in their mind before starting to design a robot. Coming to joints, joints are used to connect various links together. Joints are of six types basically. A revolute joint, which can rotate about an axis. For example, a door which is connected by a hinge is a revolute joint, and it has 1 degree of freedom. A prismatic joint can be found in the trucks when it is unloading some sand or stones, and the prismatic joint helps in this motion. A screw joint is again a 1 degree of freedom mechanism. A cylindrical joint can rotate about its axis and translate about its axis. A spherical joint, for example, is our shoulder, which can be used to control motion in three dimensions, that is X, Y, and Z axis. The revolute joint helps, the spherical joint helps in controlling the motion in three different axes. Next is a planar joint. A planar joint is something which moves on a plane. The planar joint consists of two parts, as you can see here, and it is an x-axis and y-axis. It can translate, and it can rotate about the xy plane. Coming to the sensors, sensors play an important role in robots. This is a gyro sensor, which is used to determine the orientation of the object, that is orientation of links or the orientation of the entire robot. As you can see on the top left, you can find me moving the sensor, and you can read the values on the screen and display it as an graphics. So this sensors play an important role in giving a feedback. Now we shall see what a robotic system is. A robotic system consists of a mechanism, that is the hardware part of it, which is visible to our eyes and does most of the jobs. And it's under controller, which contains the electronics, that is a microcontroller, and the program which needs to be fed to it. The mechanism gives a feedback signal through a sensor to the controller. This controller, on the other hand, processes them and gives the actuation signals to the robot or the mechanism. You can see a jumbo robot over here, which is capable of walking on its own. It is a soft robot. Now it has all supply and back travel. So this is a 3D robotic lizard in which the joint you can see is flexible in nature. The revolute joints are, the links are connected through revolute joints, and these joints are flexible in nature and provide a motion to the lizard to walk forward. This was done by me at the BEES lab of IISc in the year 2018. this robot has everything on its own. That is the power supply, the program, and the hardware on this own. Coming to a brief introduction about mechanisms which form a backbone to robots, you can see a four-bar mechanism on the screen. As you can see, L1, L2, L3, and L4 are the four links involved in this four-bar mechanism, and they're connected by four joints, namely 1, 2, 3, and 4. These links can be anything like binary, ternary, or quaternary, as we have seen earlier, and the joints can be revolute, prismatic, screw, cylindrical, spherical, or planar, which can connect these two links together. Coming to a case study where a foldable mechanism, that is a foldable stair, is made, and it consists of a four-bar mechanism and a crank and slider mechanism. This was published by me in 2014 in the Procedia Engineering Journal. So as you can see on the screen, the green color marking shows the crank and slider mechanism, and the yellow color marking shows the four-bar mechanism. It is connected by revolute joints completely, except one which is translatory, and it is actuated. The working of the foldable stair, that is an introduction to mechanism. I'm just showing it because you can find what a mechanism is before entering into robo mechanisms, which are a little complicated. This foldable stair, when actuated over here, it comes back and it folds itself. A video of it is over here. It is a computer controlled foldable stair. This is a foldable stair which can be used when there is no power supply. When there is power, a motor can be used to actuate it. And when there is no power, you can use a hoist to take the stair upward. Coming to a case study on on-floor and in-pipe snake robo, this is a robo which was made by me in 2015, which consists of higher pair links. These links are in contact with the segment one over here, and these form a higher pair link, 1, 2, 3, and 4, which are actuated in such a way that the module one segment, that is the segment one and the segment two, are moving forward. The joint module consists of the following. It consists of four motors, and each motor play an important role in contributing towards extraction, extension, lift up, and turn. During contraction, the motors are inside, as you can see over here. The links are inside, and while extending outside, these links come out and push the mechanism forward. These two modules are connected by using a spring. And for lifting motion, only the bottom link is actuated and the lifting motion occurs. For making a turn, the two links on the sides are actuated and it makes a turn. There is a friction-inducing mechanism at the bottom of it. This mechanism helps it to induce friction on the ground. You can see rubber pads over here, so which provide anisotropic friction. That is friction in only one direction, and it will be smooth in the other direction. As you can see in figure B, this portion is the thing which helps in climbing the pipe. This extends outside. This is a link which extends outside and holds itself to the pipe. The spring can be seen over here. This spring helps in contraction and extension. Coming to on-floor motion, which we'll be seeing in the video further, this is achieved by propagating a wave. Here, the wave starts, the wave continues, and you find it moving forward. When this moves forward, you will be able to see it attaining, going towards the task and doing some manipulation. In pipe motion, as you can see here, there is no link outside. You can see the link outside over here and at three places, which holds the robo to its position. Then two of them are activated and the third one comes up. In the same way, the other links are activated in such a way that it moves forward. Working principle of the on floor and snake robo is seen in this video. The wave is propagated and the robot moves forward. Next, you will see how it is moving on a horizontal pipe. The same robo moves inside a horizontal pipe. The same robo is capable of moving in vertical pipes from top to bottom. Coming to a software which is known as Mech Analyzer, it is a 3D model-based software developed for effective teaching of mechanisms. The professors in universities can use them for teaching purpose, and it is completely available at free of cost for academic usage. This is done at IIT Delhi by a professor named S.K. Sahar. You will get to know about the mechanisms which can be simulated in the Mech Analyzer software. It can be downloaded from roboanalyzer.com/mechanalyzer.html. First, you need to select a mechanism, then you need to choose an inversion, and then choose the various links and change its length. You can see the link length being changed. The offset of the coupler is being changed, and it is simulated. This can be used as an effective tool to teach mechanisms to beginners. So the notations of the mechanism is given clearly by pressing a button on the right top corner. You can also plot the coupler curve and see how it is tracing the particular curve. The position of the mechanism can be seen here. The velocity can be seen over here. And the acceleration can also be plotted on the top. You can click the various joints to get to know about the velocity at that joint, or you can get to know about the joint four acceleration and joint link accelerations by clicking over here. There are various inversions which can be clicked by changing the inversion button. And you can find various other links getting fixed and the other links are moving. Having gained some knowledge about mechanisms, we will see how planar mechanisms are used in robotics. A planar mechanism means that it lies on a plane. The mechanism lies on the plane, which can be represented as X and Y. Axis. It is a 2D plane. A plane in general means 2D. This is a 2R planar manipulator where the red colored spots are the joints and it is fixed to the ground. This joint is fixed to the ground, that is, the motor is fixed over to the ground over here, and it is connected to this and to the gripper. You can see an interesting application of it, where a 2R serial manipulator is being used to write all the 26 English letters. I have named this robo as Alpha Writer which you can also try making one. It is a computer controlled alpha writer where if you press A on the screen, the robot writes the letter. We will be seeing alphabet B and C. Once pressed, I think the letter C is going to be written now. The button is pressed, the robot receives the signal and it writes the letter C. Next comes a very basic mechanism, a FOBA mechanism, as I explained earlier, which can be used or inspired by nature. It is being used in nature, that is, a skull is being shown of a parrot fish. A FOBA mechanism which exists in nature. The blue link is the fixed link. Red, green, and the pink ones are moving. A similar application can be found in bio-inspired robots which have speaking capacity. I have made a rolling robot using FOBA mechanism, which can be seen over here. The joints over here represent are made out of wood. You can see the actuators, the four DC motors over here, and the power supply over here. It is externally powered. A video of it can be seen now. It is capable of traveling in a straight line as it does now. It can also take a turn and it can climb over obstacles and move forward. So the robot is rotating on the floor. Now there are obstacles on the floor, small obstacles, and it is trying to overcome it and move forward. This is a cluttered environment and robot tries to move forward on it. Coming to the next parallel manipulator, this is a parallel. So far we have seen serial manipulators and loop mechanisms. Two are serial manipulator and a loop mechanism, that is a FOBA mechanism. Now we will see a 3RRR planar manipulator. The RRR in this denotes that there are three revolute joints, one over here, one over here, and one over here. So these three revolute joints are present three in number. So it's called as a 3RRR parallel manipulator, and it is used to move this platform, which can be used in real life to measure the vibration of a prototype, the vibration of a building or something like that in case of earthquake and so on. This is a computer controlled 3RRR parallel manipulator, but I am showing a video where it is controlled using joystick. Next, coming to a crank and slider mechanism, crank and slider mechanisms can also be used in robots. And the principle is that there is one joint which is prismatic in nature in this crank and slider mechanism. So a snake robot, which was made by me during my bachelor's project, is shown over here. The simulation of it is shown on the top. It's going in a straight line. As you can see, this there are two crank and slider mechanisms, one over here and one over here, which pushes the segments in front of it forward. You can see the segment one moving forward, and now you can see the segment two moving forward, and the robot on the whole has moved a step forward. So for side winding motion, the robot is capable of moving on the sides. It happens in simulation and this happens in reality. Coming to inspirations from biological sources, a lizard always fascinates me because it keeps walking on the ceiling of my house very often. A bio-inspired design is something which you can take inspiration from biology, biological creatures, and you can try to make a mechanism out of it. You can see a fiber mechanism being used to create this lizard robot. There's a fiber mechanism over here and fiber mechanism over here. There are two mechanisms on the sides, that is fiber mechanism. There are totally four fiber mechanisms connected together, which makes this lizard robot. You can see a sketch of it over here. There are only four motors which are actuated. That is joint number 1, joint number 5, joint number 11, and joint number 12. So once they are actuated, the robot takes up the shape of a lizard and moves forward. So this mechanism, you can see the head part over here, the body over here, the body side over here. And the tail of it over here. So this four actuators take control of the entire mechanism, and the joints which are in blue are passive joints. They are not actuated. So this is an experimental work, and the lizard is capable of moving forward. So far we have seen planar mechanisms, that is mechanisms which operate on the plane. Now we will come to see a few spatial mechanisms which are used in robots. Spatial mechanisms are mechanisms which operate in a three-dimensional environment, that is along X, Y, and Z axis. So they can be manipulators or mobile robots, which we will be seeing now. This is a serial manipulator, a three-axis serial manipulator, which is being used to control or pick and place some objects. So a computer GUI is on the left side, and the prototype of it is on the right. You can see it is a very simple robot having a 9G servo motor over here, a 9G servo motor over here, and there's another motor which is at the bottom of it, which cannot be seen over here. This is a video where the robot is computer controlled. You can build these kind of robots at times of crisis which you are facing now, to build a robot where you can control it from a computer and do some operations or tasks which are needed for people. This robot would serve as a good example for that. So the CAD model can be rotated, as you can see now. So coming to a reconfigurable modular hybrid parallel manipulator, this is my invention which I have contributed to the world and the open source community. You can take up this hardware and you can design your own six-axis hybrid manipulator, as well as it can be reconfigured into a parallel manipulator. As you can see here in this slide, this red spots are fixed to the ground. The other joints are passive in nature. This is a prismatic joint, which is passive in nature. This joint and this joint are actuated. So the mechanism has 2 degrees of freedom, and 3 such modules of it is needed. You can see the 3 modules on the right. Coming to assembling these in series, that is, this cannot be called as a serial manipulator. Of course, it appears to be like a serial manipulator because it has loops in it. It is called as a hybrid deconfigurable modular hybrid parallel manipulator. So you can see the graphical user interface for it, which I have built, which I am ready to share with you. If you are interested, you can mail me to my email ID, which is over here. And you can make 3 modules of it, and you can connect it in series, one on each plane, and you can make it have 6 axes, 1, 2 here, 3, 4 here, 5 and 6 over here. The same modules can be arranged in parallel to get a parallel manipulator, which is again has 6 degrees of freedom. So this complete robo is operated by only revolute joints, and this is a parallel manipulator without any active prismatic joints. That is, no linear actuators are needed to actuate these manipulators. The prototype of it, this is the first prototype which I have made using things which are available at home. You can see the actuators over here. These are the actuators. There's another actuator at the back. This is second module, and this is the third module. You can note down this green portion which is at the bottom of it. This would serve as a reference in the upcoming slides so that you can see the modules being built with it. You can see the first module, middle module over here, that is the forming the base, and you can see the second module over here, and you can see the third module over here. So this prototype of the hybrid manipulator was made to test something called as static testing, so whether it is able to bear the load and able to stand on its own. Now coming to the prototype of the parallel robo, you can see that same green color structure over here, that is green module, and the other 2 modules over here. So this module and these 3 modules contribute in making the parallel manipulator. You can see the spherical joints on the top. The robo is connected to the platform, that is the place where the required things are, manipulations will be done using spherical manipulators, spherical joints. So working of this robo can be seen now. A simulation of it is shown, that is the graphical user interface. The CAD model is now being rotated. Next, you will be seeing a parallel manipulator. The 3 modules are connected in parallel. And this is the prototype of it. Coming to the softwares which can be used to design robots, there are multiple softwares which are available on commercial basis, but I'm showing softwares which are open source, or rather free, available at free of cost. FreeCAD is a good 3D modeling software where you can model your robo. It is simple to learn, and there are a lot of tutorials on the website. Next, we will see about Bullet real-time physics simulation. It is a bullet physics library which is added to the computer, and you can do simulation of the work. Here you can model the robo, and here you can simulate the robo and see, so that you can analyze the various dynamics and kinematics of it. for doing an operation on bullet physics, there is a need for unified robot description format. This is a format in which you need to feed the robot to the software. So as you can see here, it is written in XML language, that is a language which can be understood by the machine as well as humans. The link name is the base link, and the visual is started over here. What and all has to be visualized is put inside after this. The origin of the robo is at X, Y, and Z, which is 0, 0, 0. The RPY, that is roll, pitch, and yaw of the robo, can be seen over here. The values are given. The geometry of the robo can be imported as a STL file from the modeling software, and it can be stored over here. And you can scale the model using the scaling factor along the X, Y, and Z direction. So the geometry is closed over here, and the material name is defined. The material name is nothing but blue. The link of the robo has to be blue, and the color of RGBA, that is the color which the robo has to be, the value is given over here, and then the material, visual, and the links are closed. Here you will see a robotic scorpion which was simulated in bullet physics, and it is a project which was made by me recently. You can do a lot of other research by building a robo on bullet physics. This is computer-aided multi-body dynamic analysis using a commercial software called as MSE Adams. So the side shifting of the side jumping of the robo can be seen over here in this video. So multi-body dynamics, as I showed earlier, whatever happens in graphics will happen in reality, and what is going to happen in reality is shown in multi-body dynamic analysis softwares. So you can see recollect this example which I showed earlier. Coming to the mathematics which are involved in designing the robots, we will be seeing two case studies where a mobile robot, that is a snake robot, is being used. And we'll be seeing another mobile robo where a wheel of particular design will be used. You can refer to these two books, that is Introduction to Robotics by S.K. Saha and Robotics Fundamental Concepts and Analysis by Asteva Boshel, if you want to gain more knowledge in the area of mathematics related to robots. Now coming to a fiber mechanism based snake robo, as I had shown earlier, this robo will be explained in detail now. You can see the CAD model of it on the left side, and you can see the 3D printed model of it on the right side. The mechanism is as follows. The fiber mechanism with links over here are shown here. This is the friction anchor in the robo, that is the robo moves by inducing friction on the ground. There's one more friction anchor at the back. So it is made up of quaternary links, ternary links, binary links. The example of a binary link are the black patches which are over here. The example of a ternary link is a pink color link which is over here. Example of a quaternary link is a blue one which is over here. In the quaternary link, you can see one joint over here, second joint over here, the third joint over here, and the fourth joint over here. So this blue color link is called as the quaternary link because it is connected to four other joints. This is a module of the robo where once you get a idea, you need to label all the link parameters and the joint, assign numbers to the joint. A prototype of the module can be seen on the right. The functions of the module are as follows. They are used to contract the segment, extend the segment, make a right turn, and make a left turn. This was presented at IEEE Robio conference in the year 2015. So the contracted position, you can see both the actuators and the contracted state. When it is moving forward, these two are pushed forward, and when taking a right turn, only the link on the left is rotated, and while taking a left turn, the link on the right is rotated. And now coming to the calculations, the calculating the distance it moves forward, it can be calculated by drawing a figure like this. You can see various parameters on this. Ultimate aim is to find out how much distance d it has moved forward per push of the robo. So it can be calculated as follows. It is based on the link 2 and its angle, link 4 and its angle. This is for x1, and x2, that is over, which is over here, is also based on link 4 and link 2. Link 4 and link 2. The angle of link 4 and link 2. So this is the link. The distance is calculated by subtracting x2 from x1. And you can see that this two equations can be solved algebraically if some parameter, say L2 or L4, is unknown. You can assign the distance it has to move, and then you can solve for L2 and or you can solve for L4 also if the parameters are known. Coming to the inverse kinematics of the robot, I have done this inverse kinematics not by mathematical ways, but by creating a lookup table. Lookup table is something where you can design a robo initially by assigning certain links, and then you need to first plot the angle between the servo angle, that is, which is over here, and the output link angle, which is OT, which is over here. So this inverse kinematics lookup table will tell you if the servo angle is 60 degree, then the output link would have rotated 5 degrees. So by this, you can find out the inverse kinematics. Coming to the rectilinear motion, that is motion moving, the motion of the snake robo moving forward. So the picture on the left shows A, B, and C shows it shows the robo taking one step forward. The picture on the right shows it moving on the sides. You will be able to see a video soon. And this is the turning motion of the robo, and you can see it over here. And this is the working of the snake robo. Initially, the simulation was done, and it was seen that it was able to move in a straight line, move sideways, and take a turn. Now it is moving in a straight line. It's going to move sideways. And now it is going to take a turn. Now coming to the second case study, the problem is that there are stairs with overhangs. Overhangs means a small protrusion outside the stair which would enable people to keep their leg completely. So this overhangs, if they are on stairs, it is difficult for a normal stair climbing robo to climb up the stairs. So in this problem, we try to solve this problem by creating a specially shaped wheel, which would be discussed now. This is the prototype of the stair climbing robo. This was done by a team of 6 people: Ajinkya Bole, Sri Harsha, myself, Jay Dixit, Suril Shah, and Madhav Krishna. Suril Shah is a professor at IIT Jodhpur, and Madhav Krishna is a professor at IIIT Hyderabad. So the problem existing with the mobile robots which are available currently is that if the wheel size is less than the height of the stair, then there are chances for it to get jammed. This is because the traction force, which is over here, and the normal force, which is over here, produce a resultant force which is in this direction, that is downward direction. Since it produces a resultant in downward direction, these 3 robots, which are existing in the literature, are not able to climb up stairs which have overhangs on it. So we have decided to see this problem in a completely different way so that the wheels can be modified and it can move forward. This is a rocker bogey mechanism which does not climb up the stairs with overhands. So solving this problem, if the wheel is circular in nature, completely circular in nature, the traction force is over here, the normal force is over here, and the resultant is over here, that is the downward direction. So only if the resultant force is in the upward direction, the robot will be able to climb up the stairs. So the traction force, if you are going to see in the modified wheels, where we have given a mathematical model on how to model the wheel circles and the outer diameter of the primary circle. So the traction is over here, the normal force is over here, and the resultant force is in the upward direction when compared to the horizontal surface. So this robo has the capacity to move up. So the how this robo was designed is that by choosing child circle and parent circle. The parent circle is given by RP and the child circle is given by RC. The length of the dia of this child circle is 20 mm. So other design considerations which we took into account is that the module of the robo, which is this module 1, module 2, module 3. So these three modules should not attain a position like this. So what we did is we followed the International Building Code, that is IBC standard. IBC has set a standard, and this code has to be followed in urban areas to build construct a staircase. If the staircases are constructed according to the IBC standards, this robot will definitely be able to climb those stairs. We have done a multi-objective optimization where by taking into consideration the size of the wheel, the size of the parent circle, the length of the module, and other things. So in this condition should not occur. That is one of the conditions which we took. If this condition is to occur, then the robo would keep falling down. And the second condition is that there should not be any gap between the child circle. If there's a gap between the child circle, then the chance of slip to occur in these sections is very largely possible. And there are three types of wheels, and we tried with. One is the A, that is a smooth wheel, and the normal wheel, which is commercially available, and our wheel, which we have designed. So you will be able to see that in the experiments, the robots with the normal wheels will get stuck in this overhang, but the wheel which we have designed will take its step upward and go and climb the stairs. This will be seen in this video now. So we have explained how it was, what all the key contributions and the other factors which are taken into consideration for designing this robot. So this robot is getting stuck in because the wheel is very smooth and the resultant force is in the downward direction. So here the resultant force is in the upward direction and the robot climbs up. So this is the staircase number one, which we tried. Initially, we did all the simulations in a software to find out the conditions, whether it is able to roll up the stair or not. So this is the second noise condition. That is noise in here in the sense the different overhangs are being tried out, lengths of overhangs. So the length of the overhang here is different in the third level. This was solved using Tabuchi based gray analysis, forming a L9 Tabuchi matrix. for noise factor level 1, you can see it climbing up. This is for on staircase number 2, where the overhangs are of a different length. This is staircase number 3, where the overhang is of another value. So to validate the robustness, we tried climbing various stairs. We tried making the robot climb various stairs. These are stairs in reality. Of course, these don't have overhangs, but it is also able to climb stairs which don't have overhangs also. The next video you'll be seeing it standalone, that is the batteries, everything is kept on the robot and it is capable of climbing it with of climbing stairs which have overhangs. So coming to the robot design steps, as we saw now indirectly that a certain step was taken to explain how a robot can be designed. First, this step is called as crawl, fix, crawl, walk, climb and fly. So first you need to make a robot which can actually fix on the ground, that is links are fixed to the ground such as a manipulator. Then try making a robot which can crawl on the ground. So once you have gained control over fix and crawl, it will be little easy for you to make a real robot which can be able to walk. Once you make a walking robot, then you can make a robot which can climb stairs, which we saw recently. And there are robots which can fly, that is called as aerial robots, which I'm currently working on. Due to the time limit, I'm not showing anything about the aerial robots right now. So, and then after climbing, you can try to make something which fly. So fix, crawl, walk, climb and fly are the design steps which you can follow to make a robot in reality and to make the toughest robot and contribute to the society by making useful robots. So the fix, crawl, climb robot, fix, crawl, walk, climb and fly approach is explained here. Initially it was fixed, now it crawls, it walks, and now it climbs. So coming to a software called as RoboAnalyzer, which was developed at IIT Delhi, and this is a software which you can use to teach the DH parameters, Denver Thartenberg parameters in a robot. And this product, robot can be seen over here. Robo software can be seen over here. This software is actually available at free of cost and professors can download it and use it. It was developed by SK Saha at the Mechanical Engineering Department of IIT Delhi. You can also give a feedback about the software after seeing it. The feedback button is on the top of the screen. Now we will see how a 3-axis robo is being designed in this software. The DH parameters of the robot are seen over here. The values are being fed to it. You can see the marker moving and which shows the transformations which are available in the robot. The transformation matrices can be seen by clicking on the link configuration and updating it. now the final and the initial values are being set up. And the robo is going to be simulated. Now it is trying to plot the workspace of the robo. That is the space within which it can work. Coming to a book on computer controlled robots, I have written a book where you can build your own computer controlled robots from scratch. It is available on Amazon in the Kindle version as well as the paperback version. You can buy it from Amazon. So this book teaches you how to build your own computer controlled robots from scratch, that is from the design to the GUI, and the software for all the robots are given in this book. So if you want to set up a lab in your institute or somewhere else, you need to have a best 3D printer, instrument and tools, and then you need to have a robotic arm, pneumatic technology, vacuum technology, latest electronic components, and robot research platforms in it. I'll be happy to help you out if you're interested in setting up your own lab at free of cost. This is a robo. This is done by Brabo Automation, which belongs to Tata. And I thank everyone for attending this webinar. And you can post your questions now in the chat box, and I'll be happy to answer them. You can also mail me the feedback at vsrajashekhar@gmail.com. If you have any doubts, feel free to ask.
Actually, your first question, Sagar Kumar Tarai has asked, which software is good for a fresh robotics to learn student? Robotics learn student.
The best software, there's no particular software which is the best, but there are series of softwares which I showed you. That is, FreeCAD can be used to create models of the software robo. And if you want to learn robotics, then you can use this software called as Robo Analyzer to understand the basics of robots, and also Mech Analyzer, which I showed you, can be used to understand the robots, and then you can build your own robo using the software set of softwares called as modeling software and multi-body dynamic analysis using MSA Adams, and then you can control it using the GUI which I have mentioned in this book. Any more questions? So if you have no more questions,
good afternoon, everyone. So actually, it's a very nice day, and we got many useful information on today's webinar. So I thank Mr. Rajashekhar VS, Project Assistant, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, for delivering his webinar on the topic.
You can ask any questions if you want.
Yes, Mr. Rajashekhar, I have a question here. Yeah. So can you
yes,
explain? In the current applications of robo in the this COVID-19 period. So what and all could be done, and what are the various applications which are practiced now?
Yeah, so COVID-19 uses mobile robots, which are being used widely to test the patient who are coming to the hospital. And this can be made using four-wheeled robots, or you can also use a computer-controlled robo, so that you need not touch the patient or anything which is related to harmful, like the COVID-19 virus. So you can make computer-controlled robots, which are very simple, using processing IDE software.
Thank you very much. Yeah, here are some questions. I hope you can see it. Which are the softwares used to build robo circuits? The question robo is posted by Mr. Sidhu Palaimani.
Robot circuits, I don't actually work on circuits. I only work on designing the mechanical aspects of it. So I'm not the right person to answer anything related to circuits.
So any other questions?
Actually, Rajasekhar, I think there is no more questions, so we will start the vote of thanks now.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Rajasekhar. Surely it was very informative and got more basic details. So it could be very useful for those who are also in the beginning stage to start their career in the field of robotics. Also, it will be very useful for those who are already working in the field. You give more useful information. And I thank Mr. Rajasekhar, VS, Project Assistant, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, for delivering his wonderful speech on the design of robots. So he narrated the things in a very well way, that is, well-organized way. So this, for starting, he mentioned about the different types of robots and also different types of joints are well explained with the case studies, the different mechanisms, and he also explained its application. And some of the applications are also very interesting, like this Alpha Writer, lizard robots, the robots which had the movement, like crawling movement, like snake, the snake robots. And one more thing, the 3D printed robot. Yeah, actually, before some 3 or 4 weeks before and some 2 months before, we had some interesting topics, webinars on based on 3D printers. And in both the 3D printers, we were just discussing about the more recently developing techniques and all. And here, robotics is also one more technique which is in the booming stage. And a lot of work could be done, and it could be automated using this robotics field. And again, the collaboration of these two fields, that is 3D printers and application of 3D printers in robotics, and again, vice versa, it will be, I think so. So we could easily understand all the technologies which are being developed now are dependent on each other. And any person or any engineer, so we should have a good knowledge on the different fields. So from the series of webinars, I am able to understand this clearly. And he also explained about the different open source softwares where the beginners could also use and get the basic knowledge. So we have to practice by ourselves. And so this session was really wonderful and informative. Once again, I thank you, Mr. Rajasekhar. And I also thank our management of SA Welcome, Engineering sir. College. Yeah, thank you. I also thank the management of SA Engineering College for supporting us to organize this kind of informative webinars every week. And also, I would like to thank our advisor. I would also like to thank our principal, Dr. G.S. Kumaraswamy, for his continuous support for us. And he also, being a person belonging to our department, he also suggested many topics. And even he himself presented a topic some weeks before. I thank you, sir. And also, I would like to thank all the faculties of our Department of Mechanical Engineering for their continuous support. And my special thanks to Mr. Danish for arranging this webinar. And also, he hosted this entire webinar. Thank you, Mr. Danish. And once again, I thank all the participants who spend your time to learn some certain things new. I thank you all. And on a whole, this webinar is very more informative. and very interesting. I thank you all once again. Yeah, thank you.